Welcome to Ball Busters Live. I'm your host, Nathan Oakley, and if you are new to this channel, or you've not done so already, then be sure to subscribe and hit the bell notification icon to keep up to date with the Flat Earth debate. If you'd like to join the community debate, then go to nathanoakley.com and check out the Flat Earth debate forum. If you'd like to support this channel, there is a super chat that runs alongside each of these shows while they're live, and there's also a PayPal, Patreon and crypto link in the info box below the video. Now joining me on this Ball Busters tonight is Quantum Eraser, Betty Van Velsen, Sleeping Warrior and Slick James Johnson. Good to have you all.
Hey.
Hey, good evening.
Good evening.
Hello.
Hello. There, Slick? Last but not least, Slick James Johnson.
Yes, I am there. Hello. Good to have you.
Maybe joined by others. If we are, then hopefully there won't be too much interruption as we do so. But this video will serve as a response to Bob Nodell. So just to give anybody who isn't aware of the situation a bit of background, I've approached Bob Nodell in regards to the Netflix claim that scientific proof has been provided of Earth's rotation. And based on the non-adherence to the scientific method, I have made an attempt, let's put it that way, to point this out, this error out to Bob Nodell. It hasn't been well received and a response video has ensued, and this is essentially what we'll be addressing this evening. So I know John has worked quite hard on a presentation to address point by point some of the issues in Bob's video. I don't know if you want me to hand straight over to you, John.
Yeah, we can start here in the next minute or so. I'm getting an echo. All right, so what I did with Bob's performance yesterday, I pulled out a 27-minute hack from the performance. I'm not going to play the whole video, but we're going to just deal with the more or less attacks against you, right? It's from 12:33 to 29:28. I counted during that time period 42 at-home fallacies. So I'm not going to be stopping at those at-home fallacies, but there's 42 of them. Maybe towards the end, I might stop. I'm going to do a little freelancing, and we'll pull a couple out. But it's painfully obvious, if anyone's listening to this, what's going down here. So, we ready?
Yeah, ready when you are.
So what I'm going to do is I'm going to play parts of the video, the screen sharing, fine, okay?
Yeah, you present to the audience now so everyone can see.
Okay, so what I'm going to do is we're just going to run through the parts of the video, and then I'm going to stop and then remark at the comments. So, let's go.
Over to this. And I'm going to take a drink really quick. Okay, let's continue on. So as far as the Nathan Oakley debacle last week, I have received many emails over the past week, and a few were from scientists that sent me information providing proof using Nathan's scientific method that not only proves the
Well, number one, we're going to need the names and the disciplines of each of these so-called scientists, Bob, and exactly what they provided. And I sure hope that what you have scrolling on the screen for the next 27 minutes isn't one of which they provided. That rag's not going to cut it. Number two, it's not Nathan's scientific method. It's just the scientific method. Number three, what's this proof? Because for scientific evidence, you have to provide the natural phenomena observed, the hypothesis, the independent, dependent, and controlled variables, and the null hypothesis that was rejected or falsified. Nathan asked you for these on your show, and you didn't provide them, and you haven't provided them here. So we're still waiting on them.
Also proves that it is the ether that is in motion around the Earth. I have also received additional data on the Sagnac experiment, and yes, I am absolutely calling it an experiment now, because Sagnac was absolutely operating within the scientific method before, during, and after this experiment?
Well, that should be easy to confirm, but we're still waiting. Again, natural phenomena observed, the hypothesis, independent, dependent, and control variables, and the null hypothesis.
Just because Malcolm Bowden's video did not go into those details, it doesn't mean that they weren't documented and elaborated upon. They were.
Still waiting, and I sure hope that elaboration isn't running on your screen right now.
So it turns out that Nathan Oakley was dead wrong about Sanyak and his methods, because like any pretender clown, he not only didn't have the faintest idea what was actually happening in this experiment, but he is also incapable of understanding anything about the actual practice of the scientific method. Nathan has become the king of handwave dismissals because he has absolutely no understanding or background in science.
Really? Hey, Nathan, what's the scientific method?
Observe a natural phenomena, formulate a hypothesis, perform systematic experimentation?
It sounds like he knows what he's talking about, Bob. And pretender clown? Bob, you've gone a little too far there, mister. That's copyrighted. It's the description I coined for Dunning-Kruger spinning space monkeys years ago. So, you'll be hearing from my representatives.
Scientific method was alive and well before the onset of Einstein, and it was at that point where science largely became mathematical constructs and took us off the scientific path for the past 100 years.
So you're saying that there hasn't been any actual scientific experiments for 100 years? I got five right here. We can go with Kim, Yahoo, a delayed choice quantum eraser, physical review letters in 2000. We got Groblacker, 2007, an experimental test of non-local realism. We got Lakwix, 2011, experimental non-classicality of an indivisible quantum system from nature. Number four is Ao Sung Ma, 2013, quantum eraser with the causally disconnected choice from PNAS. And number five, Manning et al., Wheeler's delayed choice Gin-Duncan experiment with the single atom from nature physics. So that just destroyed your whole point right there. Let's continue.
The giants of science, like Oliver Heaviside, Henri Poincaré, James Clerk Maxwell, Albert Michelson, George Sagnac, Edward Morley, and last but certainly not least, Nikola Tesla, all knew of the ether and did many experiments based on the absolute necessity of its existence. Even science today acknowledges it and documents it fully.
Okay, ready? Give them to us. Citations, please, from all of your name drops, Bob. And you said science acknowledges and documents? Science isn't an entity or a result. It's a method, the scientific method. Science doesn't acknowledge, document, say, jump, run, swim, point to, or do to hokey pokey. To do such things takes sentience, prescience, and intelligence to be alive. Science isn't alive, therefore, reification fallacy times two.
Let's not forget that if the ether did not exist, the Sagnac effect and ring laser gyroscopes would not exist either.
Why? Did the ether physically construct the gyros and the Sagnac experiments? That's non sequitur on steroids.
So when it comes to science, it looks like we can take the impotent rants of a grocery store delivery boy that thinks he knows everything there is to know about the scientific method, or I can go by the experimental results of the giants in science, physics, and engineering, known as Heaviside, Poincaré, Maxwell, Michelson, Sagnac, and Tesla, who brought us the 21st century technology based on their work.
So we got the name drops again. Listen, science isn't adjudicated by dropping names. It's adjudicated by following the scientific method. And we're still waiting for the natural phenomena observed, hypothesis, independent dependent control variables, and the null hypothesis, Bob. And who brought us the 21st century technology? From Scientific American in 2017. Without quantum mechanics, there would be no transistor, and hence no personal computer, no laser, and hence no Blu-ray players. From the same article, this information age, of course, came about because of semiconductors and solid-state physics, which were enabled by what? Quantum mechanics. From Steven Weinberg, Nobel Prize in Physics, he says, I'm tempted to say that without quantum mechanics, we'd be back in the Dark Ages. I guess more accurately, without quantum mechanics, we'd be back in the 19th century. Steam engines and telegraph signals. And by the way, engineering isn't science. Neither is technology.
One of these scientists disagreed vehemently with Albert Einstein and considered him to be nothing more than a fuzzy-haired crackpot. For those of you that are inclined to believe and follow the rantings of a grocery delivery boy who runs a Jerry Springer-themed hangout, all I can say is you are well matched to the intellect found there, and you are welcome to believe what you want. Do not expect me to bring myself or the Globusters team down to that level of thinking, though.
What level of thinking is that, Bob? You failed to mention that. Also, can you please list the levels of thinking so we can see where your flailing contrived ad hominems compare with each other? And are you comparing Nathan to Einstein? And finally, aren't you bringing yourself down right now? Let's continue.
Now, those of you that have not fallen too far into the brain dead antics of the Nathan Elkley clown show, I would like to point something out that showcases the utter ignorance and stupidity that is apparent from a person with zero training in science. Nathan is always pointing out that in a scientific experiment, one must have a hypothesis, a natural or observed phenomenon, a dependent and independent variable, and finally, a conclusion that is represented via a scientific theory. Great. Nathan is correct about this, and no one is disputing this point at all.
Well, then the argument's over, Bob. Nathan is correct. That was Nathan's entire argument. So if he's correct, and he most certainly is, then your entire feebly executed crackpot response here is DOA, dead on arrival. We could end here. We could do it, but you didn't end, so we're not going to end.
Or did we dispute Globusters when Nathan hostile guest?
Wait a second. You did dispute it when you said science has proven the ether, which is a reification fallacy in pseudoscience. And this hostile guest, I don't know where you got this from. I and many others thought that Nathan was quite reserved. We can all go back and evaluate it again when you put your publicly hidden videos back up, Bob.
Nathan, can I just say that I don't think John's sound is coming through. I don't think you're passing it through properly.
Yeah, everything's fine.
Can I continue?
Yeah.
Down. All right, continue. So where Nathan goes totally wrong is when he continually asserts that I claimed I performed a fiber optic gyro experiment and then asserted that it proved the ether. I have never performed any experiment, scientific or otherwise, with a fiber optic gyro, period. I simply reported on Rick Zimmerman's observational results that he did with his fiber optic gyro.
Nathan never claimed, let alone continuously, that you performed a fiber optic gyro experiment, Bob. You did. We'll get to that in a few seconds. Nathan stopped you when you said science proved the ether, Bob. And, like I said, you did. Right? Do you remember this? Give me a moment. So, this has been on the circuit for about 4 months now. It's an excerpt taken out from Behind the Curve. So, you said, recently we carried out an experiment to test the rotation of the Earth. If the Earth is spinning at one rotation every 24 hours, that means every hour it has to turn 15 degrees. And a gyroscope is mounted anywhere on the Earth, it's going to drift, right? So, don't know what you're talking about there, Bob.
Not make any mistake in the Behind the Curve movie, because all I did was report on those results. Period,
right? Yes, we just seen it, Bob. You made a big mistake. You called the gyro an experiment on the Behind the Curve documentary. We just witnessed it. Of which it is not, which you have already admitted. Period.
During the part of the movie where I was talking to YouTuber X Heliocentric and saying that if the results got out as they were, they would not look good for the flat Earth.
Really, Bob? Riddle me this. Why would the results not look good for the flat Earth since you are already on board with the ether as the cause? Correct? That doesn't follow. There's a contradiction in there. Implicitly. So I don't know. You're going to have to square that one away. I'm not saying it.
Earth. I then stated that the results were still a secret because Rick Zimmerman had not given me the okay to release them yet. 2 days or so after that video was shot, Rick gave me permission to release those results because we had realized what it was we were actually dealing with. That it was actually the ether that was rotating as discovered by the Michelson-Gale experiment a century ago. And then I released those results along with a comprehensive explanation on the very next Globusters show.
So the ether is proved again now by the Michelson-Gale experiment, right, Bob? Okay, we're still waiting. Natural phenomena observed, hypothesis, independent, dependent, and control variables. No hypothesis, Bob. Moreover, we already just seen and heard that you said we carried out an experiment with a fiber optic gyro. So which is it? Or would you like to redefine the term we? You also told Nathan multiple times that the fiber optic gyro wasn't an experiment. In fact, that was your entire defense against Nathan. So again, which is it?
I also sent that very same explanation to Daniel Clark, the director of Behind the Curve, in which he promptly ignored them and went on to paint Jaron and I as fools in his pathetic movie that all Globers now cling to as proof positive of rotation and curvature.
So why did the ballers cling to it? Oh, Bob, because you said it was an experiment and that it wasn't looking good. And that you had 20 G's in the freaking gyro. You see why now? Sidebar, every single baller that has signed off and indicted Bob on this issue is also a self-admitted pretender clown. Why? Because they too don't know what an experiment is.
Contrary to popular belief, I was never out to cover up any results of our observations. And if they showed the Earth was a ball, we would report the results honestly. Unfortunately, the recorded observations did not support the globe model. Unless, of course, you follow pretender clown Nathan Oakley's scientific expertise on these results. Why do I say this? Okay, guys, forget Nathan and his idiotic one-string guitar he plays with regards to the scientific method for a minute and consider this carefully, okay? Nathan categorically claims that the ether does not exist and that no scientific...
Nathan never claimed, categorically or otherwise, that the ether does not exist, Bob. Nathan repeatedly told you that the ether can never be scientifically validated. So your entire argument against him is nothing more than a juvenile straw man fallacy. That's all it is.
Has ever proven it. He has said he will debunk any argument about the ether experiment as not being valid because, again, Nathan asserts categorically that the ether does not exist. Well, folks, Nathan's an idiot, and I'm going to tell you what the net result of his grocery store delivery boy scientific training is. Now listen up and listen carefully, because this is really very important, okay? So both fiber optic gyro and ring laser gyro technologies are designed to measure pitch, yaw, and roll, all based on a rotational axis. They are proven pieces of a technology in use by tens of thousands of navigational systems, and they are extremely precise.
We don't care about that, Bob. Technology isn't science. That's not the argument. Nathan never claimed that gyros didn't work, for goodness sakes. Nathan claimed that you couldn't scientifically validate the ether using those devices. So again, this is the same juvenile straw man fallacy. Please try and focus on the actual argument.
They're both classified as laser interferometer technology and based on what is called the Sagnac effect, which came about from the Sagnac experiment that proved the existence of the ether.
Here we go again, really. So, please provide the natural phenomena observed, the hypothesis, independent, dependent, and control variables, and the null hypothesis. We've asked this greater than 65 times, so we're going to need it.
Nathan Oakley, then we must accept that what the fiber optic gyro, as well as all ring laser gyros, are registering is indeed Earth rotation.
Wrong. Nathan's claim is you can't scientifically validate whether it's the ether or Earth's rotation as the cause. So you're still not on the argument, Bob.
You can't understand that.
Yeah, we do.
If the ether doesn't exist, as Nathan...
Nathan never asserted that the ether doesn't exist, Bob, for the 10th time. Nathan claimed that you couldn't scientifically validate the ether using those devices, and he is 100% correct.
Science guy Oakley asserts, then the battle for flat Earth is over, because there can be no other rebuttal for the measured output of rotation by a proven piece of 21st century technology. Nathan Oakley doesn't understand that by calling Sagnac, Heaviside, Poincaré, Maxwell, Michelson, Morley, Gale, and Nikola Tesla wrong, as if, about their assertions regarding the ether's existence.
I'll give you as if. Name drop again, right? Nathan never claimed either of your feeble name drops for what, the 10th, 12th time, are wrong. Nathan claimed that you couldn't scientifically validate the ether using those devices. Ergo, it's the same old straw man fallacy again, repeated over and over again.
He is unwittingly validating another pseudoscientific pretension known as Albert Einstein on his mathematically constructed Rentz-contracted version of reality.
Wrong, Bob. You're arriving at your conclusion here based on a straw man premise that Nathan claimed the ether doesn't exist. He didn't make that claim. And then you made your conclusion. Guess what that means? Your conclusion's fallacious.
Math and not observation and experimentation that reign supreme over science. people, the ether exists, and it is the ether that the fiber optic gyro and ring laser gyros have detected, and we have proven that in a myriad of ways on Globebusters.
So have you proven the ether again, right, Bob? Well, we're still waiting. We're going to need the natural phenomena observed, the hypothesis, independent, dependent, and control variables, and the null hypothesis. It's just that simple. No amount of your conviction is going to change that. So we're going to need it. Okay?
Science knows it. Science didn't know it. They would not be.
Science knows it. They would not be what? That's another reification fallacy times two, because science doesn't know anything. It's a method, and there is no they in it.
Not be looking for ways to prove Earth rotation even today. They would have simply cited the Michelson-Gale experiment and said, that's it, the Earth's rotating. They didn't, because the Michelson-Morley experiment absolutely invalidated it. It dismissed the possibility of the Earth traveling around the sun at 67,000 miles an hour and on and on and on. I have talked about this on Globebusters ad nauseum because I have researched it ad nauseum. All right. Nathan Oakley does not know what the hell he is talking about. And in fact, if you listen to him, the only thing you're going to get out of it is an idiot that is claiming that the ether doesn't exist and therefore essentially supporting the idea that the Earth is spinning. All right? That is the point here.
Ad nauseum, yeah. Same straw man again, ad nauseum. Nathan, again, never claimed that the ether doesn't exist. All right? That is the point here.
Pull his head out of his rear end. Doubting that he knows what the scientific... about. He does.
He does. You don't. Plain and simple.
Right. So Nathan validating flat Earth in a way that
only we're not really getting the sound through for the beginning part of it. It seems to be quite sporadic in terms of whether or not we get it, John.
All right. Let me try something. Wait one. All right, you got me?
Have a try. Hopefully we'll get sound.
Let's see if we get sound from this. Let me go back. Let me try. Tell me if you hear this.
No, now we're getting nothing.
Are you hearing that?
We were getting sound. It just stayed quiet for periods of chunks of time, like really quiet.
Okay, was it good here for when I just did it?
No, we got nothing.
You got nothing. Let's try it again.
It was working the way it was before, it just wasn't very good.
Let's try it again.
It's all about. He does not. Okay? Plain and simple.
How about now?
Yeah, that seems to be working again.
I'm also getting an echo too. Is everyone on mute in this hangout?
Yeah, everyone's on mute.
Okay, I'm going to start it again. Here we go.
Right, so Nathan Oakley is invalidating flat Earth in a way that most baller shills can only dream of.
Nathan's not the one dreaming here, Bob. We know who the one is dreaming. You.
And any one of you that agree with him and his idiocracy might as well throw in the towel right now and declare the Earth is a spinning ball. But don't forget to keep throwing those super chats Nathan's way, because that is all he cares about, after all. Fortunately, there are people like me, Globebusters, and F.E. Core in this community who are capable of seeing and knowing that Einstein and Nathan Oakley are wrong.
Whoa, Nathan, did you ever think in your wildest dreams that you'd be classified with Einstein? Unbelievable.
Continue. In their dismissal of the ether, and are working on explaining its nature both by observational test and experimentation. And I will also add, also by bringing the historical facts and discussion of the ether to light and also the fact that every scientific experiment performed has always returned a result of no motion to this Earth. Okay? So it is fortunate for the community that FE Core exists. FE Core is about performing true observations, science, and experimentation, and is dedicated to understanding and revealing the phenomenon that we have been lied to about for centuries. FE Core is made up of an impressive and growing group of scientists and engineers who realize that science has indeed been hijacked and compromised, as Nathan so astutely asserts. Unfortunately.
Yeah, unfortunately, and this is the whole ball of wax. Bob and FE Core. This is why Mike Kavanaugh, the president of FE Core, clumsily subsumed the argument levied against you, Bob, from Nathan. Because FE Core has splattered all over their website the term science, the true scientific method, and experiments. Let me ask you a question. What would happen if funds were solicited for experiments when there were no actual experiments conducted, right? And we're going to need a list of these scientists in here. And engineering, like I said, isn't science. So we got a big problem there. Another big problem is this study you got scrolling through the stream here the whole time, right? Let's take a look at this. This is from Space, Time, and Substance in the Ukraine, right? What's the space time, right? Isn't the space time and Einstein, ain't they synonymous? Have you ever gone to their site, Bob? They are solely designed for space time. That's all they talk about. And here's a little trick, right? You want to know if this is an actual scientific study? Here's a little trick you can do, right? You can do the find, and all you have to do is type in variable, right? What do we get? 101, and it's in variable position. There are no, this isn't an experiment. An experiment has independent, dependent, and controlled variables in them, every single one. This isn't one of those studies. This is a rag. And let me just say this. There was a study done in 2017 by Professor J. Scott Armstrong of the Wharton School at the University of Pennsylvania. You want to know what he found out? This is the title. Fewer than 1% of papers in scientific journals follow the scientific method. Right? Guess what? This is one of them. My word.
That is where Nathan ends on being correct and his money-grubbing, pseudoscientific, and drama-pushing attributes take over. Nathan was ejected from his courtesy membership of FE Core by me personally.
And why was that, Bob? You didn't give the reason why. You just ejected him. We want to know why.
I accept full responsibility for doing so.
And we'll give you that responsibility, Bob. And we'd like to know why. I'm sure the other people in FE Core would like to know, too.
FE Core has no place for drama queen idiots like Nathan, and I stand by my decision.
It looks like they have no place for scientific method either.
All right, so let's go now to this. I want to point something else out here. So moving on, I'd like to comment on yet another thing that shows Nathan Oakley only cares about views and super chats.
Appeal to intent motive fallacy.
On Sunday, March 10th, 2019, Nathan was aware that Globusters would not be doing a show. I was scheduled to shoot some video with Rick Hummer and John Pounders from the Now You See TV YouTube channel, and Jaron was sick with pneumonia. He quickly turned that into a scheme to attempt to steal the Globusters audience and drum up more viewers, so he put together a show, which he titled Ballbusters. Okay, and in case you guys didn't know, Ballbusters was my name suggestion when Jaron and I were deciding on the title of our new
show. Wait a second. What are you intimating here? Are you saying Nathan kind of divined your thoughts from the past or something and then came up with this? I mean, where are you going with this?
4 years ago, but we decided to use Globusters instead because the name did not sound quite so crass.
Yeah, well, we like crass.
Anyway, Nathan sees the opportunity to gain more followers to his shit show and not only put Globusters in the title, description, and keywords, but he also ran the show under our normal Sunday time slot. He did this because he knew people would be searching for Globusters because our video content was down and we were not live.
This is riveting. So what?
Doing that worked out quite well for Nathan because by doing that, he now has over 6,000 views on his video, where over half of it is nothing more than the panel talking about me and the mistakes I allegedly made.
Yeah, they weren't alleged. You made mistakes. And we pointed them out again here for everyone to see. I mean, they're real easy.
Not to mention a few choice insults that were in there as well.
What insults? There weren't that many insults in there. We were trying to cover for you and trying to help you. That's what we were trying to do. All you had to do was own up to it. That's it. Just say, hey, listen. Yeah, I see it. I made a mistake. That's it. It would have ended. All would have been forgiven and forgotten. But this is where we're at.
It was yet another evidence that Nathan was never out to try to help me or anyone but himself.
Here we go again. Another appeal to intent motive fallacy.
Nathan could have simply chose to contact me in private to express his concerns, but that would not generate any super chats, drama, or subscribers, so he was not interested in that. By the way, there was also one other troll in the community besides Nathan who used this tactic to steal Globusters viewers, and it worked equally well for him as he also had record numbers for his shit show. Yes, that was none other than Timmy Osmond.
So now you compared Nathan with Einstein and now with Timmy Osmond. That's great classifications right there, boy.
All right. So now we have to ask, now I have to ask, I should say, the Flat Earth community a few questions.
Yeah, we'd like to ask you a few questions. We want some answers to the questions that we already asked for like 65 times.
Did Nathan Oakley really care about helping me?
Oh, geez. Another appeal to intent motive fallacy. Here we go again.
My moment of despair. And
appeal to emotion fallacy.
Correcting a wrong. Or did he use this opportunity to berate me as a result of a two-year-old chip on his shoulder?
What are you divining his intent for? I mean, do you have special mind powers? We'd like to see those. We want to see the method that you use to arrive at that.
Is Nathan Oakley qualified in any way to dictate what is and is not science?
Yes, he is. I qualified him. Any questions?
No? Is that a rhetorical question?
Correct.
I said no. Yeah, it was a rhetorical question. To you, I answered it. Did you hear it?
Mm-hmm.
All right, let's roll on. We're almost done.
In supporting Einstein's assertions that there is no ether. And finally, is Nathan Oakley and his Flat Earth Berates show really about getting to the truth?
Yes, it is about getting to the truth.
Or is it just a show based on drama used to highlight Nathan going ballistic and losing his mind on Ball Earthers?
Wait a second. When Nathan came on your show, you gave him big ups for the show and that you watched the show. And a lot of other Flat Earthers watched the show. So what's going on here? What's this dichotomy we got going on?
And generating super chats. Whatever your answers are. I only ask that you keep things in proper perspective and consider the evidence for yourself and remain free from groupthink.
From groupthink? That's what we're remaining from, groupthink. You're in it, groupthink. F.E. Core groupthink, Bob.
In case I have not alluded to it strongly enough, let me state for the record to be perfectly clear. I believe that Nathan Oakley is...
That's the problem. You believe. We're not into beliefs. We're into proving things.
Double snake.
Oh, here we go. You know, just another one of the 42 ad hom fallacies we had to endure so far.
Only interest lies in Jerry Springer-type drama which generates division, scientific illiteracy, and utter stupidity that is now running rampant in this community.
Oh, God.
Nathan does not care who he steps on or how bad he makes.
How do you know he doesn't care? There you go again. Motive intent fallacy and divining his motives.
Flat earthers.
You ever considered carnival as a vocation?
Look, as long as those subscriptions and super chats keep coming in. I totally acknowledge, though, that everyone is free to watch anyone or anything they want.
Thank you. We will.
It is certainly your decision, and I support that. Even I have been known to tune into Jerry Springer from time to time.
Yeah, there we go. Little Jerry Springer. Little, you know, backhanded slight. Little backstab as you go out, right? Little second grade playground antics.
Okay. So I've said my
piece. Okay, you know what? I've had enough of this. Let me summarize this. So, in summary, when you peel back all the second grade playground antics, like I just said, Bob and Mike Kavanaugh from FE Corps have straw-manned red herring fallacy away from the actual argument. Here's the actual argument. There is no scientific evidence for the rotation of the Earth, whether it be ether or Earth rotation. Why? For many reasons. But the T-Rex in the room is because whether the Earth or sky is spinning is a what is question. The scientific method only adjudicates how why questions. The prosecution rests. You have no case. Bob Strawman, Nathan claims the ether doesn't exist. Again, Nathan's argument says nothing to that. There is no scientific evidence for the rotation of either the Earth or the sky. Number two, the ring laser gyro did not and never will scientifically prove Earth or ether rotation. And this is it. I've had it with this. So any comments?
Well, I do want to make I want to present some of myself. So let's either close this point or let me present my point and then we'll close at the end. Nathan?
No, I've got no points to add to that, John. I mean, this is all a big disappointment, as you know, Bob could happily be doing his thing with just a small concession. And instead, it's attack me with straw men. Just there we go. Such is life.
Slick, Betty.
Floor is yours.
Yes, go ahead.
Okay. Thanks. Present my screen, if you would, please. I'm going to take this from a different perspective. I'm going to take it from the. If Sagnac does not prove ether, what does Sagnac, quote, prove? Say that very loosely. One of the things I do want to pick up on is when Bob used the phrase, remain free from groupthink, as though that's a dirty phrase. Now, don't know about you, but I consider myself to be experienced in this discussion now. Still make mistakes, still get shit wrong. And I can own up to it when I get shit wrong. Don't we all know I've made enough over the time? But to assert the phrase, remain free from groupthink, actually rang alarm bells for me personally, because that is a divisionary tactic to try and stop people from groupthinking. Now, anybody that's fresh into this discussion, or even 6 months, 12 months, 18 months into it, requires other people's perspectives at times, because you need to run things off people and say, hey, I think A, does that make logical sense? And then somebody will say, no, you've forgotten about that. And then that'll immediately bring you back down to earth. And then you need that group think just to scattergun ideas. Because whilst we're all working out what's going on, to not be part of a group think would be suicide. So when he said that phrase, that for me was like, whoa. Second to that point is that when we were part of group think, look what happens when Nathan puts his head above the parapet and says, hang on a sec, I'm not sure that's right. Off with his head, to quote a better phrase, because that's literally what it was. So you can't criticize on the one hand remaining free from groupthink, whilst on the other hand, you slice off someone's head for disagreeing with you on topic on a point that is both valid, legitimate, and credible. I think that is an alarming sentence to say, because it is loaded. And that was an immediate reaction of mine when I heard him say that. I just thought, whoa, alarm bells were ringing. So what I'm going to do now is move back to the main point that Bob makes. And our point is that it doesn't prove that ether either exists or does not exist. It doesn't prove that ether was manipulated. The Sagnac experiment, which I'll demonstrate in a sec, what you can do is you can type in scientific method, manipulate the independent variable, and then just hit enter. And then what you can do once you get enter is you get the results, and you can look through any of these results, and they all say the same thing. If it's a scientific experiment, you've got to manipulate it, right? That is the reason why I played that song, Wiggle It. Because people remember the tune. People remember you've got to wiggle it to prove that it is science. In here, it says in blue. Just in case you're unsure, blue doesn't mean Dell's room. Blue means the text that's on screen that's highlighted in blue. The thing that is changed on purpose is called a manipulated variable. Sometimes it's called the independent variable. Designing the manipulated variable is a critical part of the experiment. It goes on, but you can click the link and you can read about it. It is required. There are numerous citations about manipulating the independent variable. Your independent variable is your presumed cause. That's what you think is causing your effect, whatever your effect is. The Sagnac experiment, or Sagnac, if you want to pronounce it the way that the French say it, it's not easy to establish what Sagnac thought was the dependent variable, because A, it's old French, and B, it's French. So it's not easy to find anything other than, and I don't believe there actually was one. I can be corrected on that, but it doesn't appear to have a valid dependent variable. That's a problem, because part of the testing is to manipulate your independent variable to observe the effects it has on the dependent variable. So it's not clear to establish what is the position originally in the paperwork. I've tried, and if there's somebody out there with a translation that's credible, then maybe I can be wrong. Maybe there was an observed phenomena. But in the absence of it, I don't know how he knows what is Sagnac's position, because it's French and it's Gothic in its style. It's old. But Bob makes a point about how all the previous experiments from Michelson Gale, Michelson Morley, Sagnac, and so on, he lists about five. He makes a point that all these he'd rather trust these scientists than a grocery delivery guy. Well, let me just put this into context, because that sentence is relevant. By 1915, Einstein publishes his general theory of relativity. By 1920, Einstein says that special relativity does not require rejecting the ether, and that gravitational field of general relativity may be called the ether, to which no state of motion can be attributed. That, to me, sounds like bullshit, nonsense, crazy stuff. But that's what is credited on the chronology of the luminiferous ether. And in 1920, that's the key date you need to be aware of. Now, bear in mind that Bob says that all the scientists all claim that the ether did exist. At least according to Wikipedia, it says by the 1920s, most scientists actually rejected the ether's existence. Now, I'm not saying that they did or did not. I'm using this to illustrate that Bob's claim that most of the scientists from the experimentation, which is all the Michelson Morley, so what we'll do is we'll work backwards from 1920, which is where Einstein comes in. Now, bearing in mind that by 1920, Einstein, most scientists did not support the existence of the ether, we can see some of the names that that Bob references. We've got Sagnac, we have Lorentz, we have Miller, Morley, we have Lorentz again. Michelson Morley, again, Lorentz, Michelson. Now, all of these people, Biddle, George Biddleberry. So all of these people are all pre-1920 and pre-Einstein. So if Bob's statement that most people are better than the grocery delivery boy, by 1920, at least according to what we're told, that most scientists did not accept the existence of the ether. Now, again, I'll be really clear. I'm not saying that the ether does or does not exist. What I'm saying is that it appears that Bob's statement might actually be wrong, because it appears that what we're taught, at least is what we're taught, is it's not confirming Bob's position. Most people did not think that the ether existed by the early 1920s. So just to put that back into context, I'll show the line again. Right, it's right up at the top. By the 1920s, most scientists rejected the ether's existence. Obviously, this was the result of Einstein, but when Bob says that most people actually accepted the ether, I'm not so sure that that's actually true, certainly by what we're told. Whether or not it's proven is a different point. I'm just saying what is the consensus by science.
It wasn't by science. It was by pseudoscientists. So it doesn't matter. This doesn't matter.
I agree. I'm just challenging the point Bob made, which was that most people, by Lorenz and all them, the names that he listed off, all supported the idea that the ether existed. Well, perhaps not. It doesn't appear to be the case. That's all I'm saying. Whether it is or not is not my position. I don't know. It's complicated. Now, what I'm going to do now, I'm going to play this slowly in the background. Speed, turn this down to half. Now, this is where it's confusing, because basically what we're trying to establish is, well, what did Sagnac actually prove, if anything? Now, as we can see, we've got the two light rays that are being bent around the rotating plane. Now, we see that this one on this side hits the reflection mirror first, but this one's not got there yet. This one is going with the rotation of the plane, the disc, but the other one over here is going against it. So what we can see is that the length of time it takes for this one to hit this side is shorter than the length of time that this one hits that side. And that's the explanation. It appears that that is so far what the Sagnac experiment is demonstrating, that if one side is spinning with the rotation of the disc, the light gets to the reflection or the reflector first, and then by the time it gets to the second reflector and then reparallels or rejoins back at the prism or whatever this thing is here, that the one that's going with the rotation gets there first. So we know that the distances are equal. We know that the time it takes for them is different because one's with the spin, the other one's without the spin. And we know that the distance and the time are the two things that are different. But what we can do is, if we were to look at this without knowing what the gist of the arguments were at all, logically and reasonably, you could conclude that one side with the spin gets to its destination quicker than the side that's going against the spin. Why does that cause an interference pattern? I don't know. Interesting observation. Is it proving something? I would say, based on my own interpretation, just my own, I'm spitballing, but it appears to me that the one that goes with the spin gets there quicker than the one that goes without the spin. And that's all that I would say is what we're looking at. Now, to jump from what we see in this test or observation or whatever you want to call it, to conclude that the ether exists is the leap of faith. Because what we can demonstrate is that as one turns, the other one gets there faster. One goes with it, one goes without it. So we can see that one appears to get there quicker because the distance is cut short. So when we go to this one, so when we go back to rearranging the formula for speed equals distance over time, we can see that the one that takes the least amount of time is the one that covers the distance in the quickest amount of speed. So it appears to me that the Sagnac experiment is simply what you're demonstrating is that if you go with the speed and it or against the speed, you can affect what happens with the interference pattern. Now, there does appear to be an effect, but what's the cause? Well, the cause appears to be the speed of the rotation. If you're going with the spin, you're going to get there quicker. If you go against the spin, you're going to get there slower because you've got to go a bit further. It's a little bit further to go against the spin. But is that proving the ether? And I would say absolutely not. So the problem we've got is, even if we accept that the Sagnac experiment actually is an experiment, to make the conclusion that it is proving the ether is fallacious, because the independent variable was not the ether. The independent variable was the speed of the rotating platter. So as you sped that up, the interference pattern became bigger. As you slowed it down, it closed the gap. But that doesn't mean anything of the ether, because the independent variable was not ether. Your independent variable was speed. So if you're going to manipulate your speed, you can then logically say, and experimentally perhaps, and John can correct me if I'm wrong, but you can conclude that as you spun your plate faster, you were able to get a bigger interference pattern. As you slowed it back down again, the gap closed. But that's all. So although it's a nifty bit of kit that he shows, and it's an interesting effect, he causes it by spinning it up faster and slowing it back down. But the problem is that claiming that it's the ether that's proven is the leap of faith, because it doesn't prove the ether, because it was not the independent variable. So that's the point that I wanted to make, that even if we accepted that it was actually an independent variable that he manipulated that proves the ether, he doesn't actually prove the ether. All he proves is that the disk that spins with the spin or against the spin is basically governed by how fast you spin it and the direction in the direction it actually travels in. And you can't really prove anything other than, well, light may have a fixed speed in this. I mean, you can hypothesize, spitball as to what this actually proves, but it definitely doesn't prove that ether exists, because you didn't manipulate the ether. You manipulated speed. So even if Bob was right about it being an experiment, he's wrong about it proving the ether. So that's me done.
Cool.
If I may, I'd like to address it from a more of a kind of... Can you hear me?
Yeah. Coming through loud and clear.
Okay. Yeah, more from kind of an ethics point of view. Because the way this whole thing started was that when they did that documentary was basically ripped apart and torn apart to make Flat Earth look bad. So the one thing that people in Flat Earth have to constantly deal with is being misrepresented. Any Flat Earther that ever deals with a global person, the first thing that you have to get through is being misrepresented. So we're all used to that. But the hard part happens when a Flat Earth person misrepresents you. Most of those things, if not all of those things Bob said, were totally misrepresentations of, you know, bringing Nathan into what happened there. Because what Nathan was doing, his sole purpose was to try to clear up the misconception so that they wouldn't make these type of mistakes and send these kind of messages out there like that to give globe people something to misrepresent. Now, what happened was they got offended by that. See, they didn't understand that they made a mistake. In their mind, everything that they did was perfectly spot on, so they didn't see it. They didn't recognize that somebody was trying to throw them a lifeline and say, hey, guys, you just don't realize that everything that you did didn't make any sense to begin with, because you weren't following science. You were just declaring. You made an observation and you threw a declaration on it. And this is what global people have done for all of since I can remember. See, so when you try to use that same mentality in Flat Earth, it doesn't work. You have to clear your mind. You can't use globe mentality in Flat Earth. Now, I know I kind of sound like a broken record with this, but this is one of those things that you kind of have to hear over and over again, because nobody is used to that. Nobody is used to understanding that you are indoctrinated to observe and declare. And if you think about it, when you listen to globe people speak, that's what they do. They observe and they declare. Look what happened with this gyroscope thing. They observed and they declared. There was no science involved whatsoever. But they thought they were doing the right thing because that's what they were brought up to do. See, so what Nathan was trying to do was make them understand that you can't just observe and declare. Flat Earth is all about getting away from observing and declaring. If you observe something and you can't understand it the scientific way, then you have to let that go. It's okay not to know. We were talking earlier about the distance to the sun. It's okay not to know the distance to the sun. It's not a major issue that if you don't know every single thing about the universe, that it's going to be a problem. And that's where most of our problems are stemming from. If you're going to be in Flat Earth, this is a message to anybody in Flat Earth, you have to clear your mind of globe mentality. You have to do that first. You can never, ever, for one second, understand Flat Earth through the lens of a globe Earth. Thank you.
Pleasure. Any more for any more?
That's it for me.
Come on, Betty, at least say something.
Yeah, what can I say? What can I add to this? I mean, it's all been said, I think. I still have... There was one line that Bob said with that the ether spins, that was detected. And I think, well, okay, so now a sort of ether spins. And I think that is still something that people can pick up and think that it's still then the rotation of the Earth. So how do we get any further with acknowledging or not acknowledging an ether? It is not scientifically validated at all to begin with, but what does it bring us further in the whole thing? So I think that when he was talking about the experiment in the Netflix documentary, I think, well, he was not on his guard, and even though he said, well, he didn't get the chance or the acknowledgement that he could give away some more of the gyro experiment. So I think that's wrong. I think that he was really surprised that the gyro did not what he wanted or expected to do. And now he has to make up with the ether. So he needs the ether too much to
work. That's the bit I'm not sure about. He does definitely want to hold on to that ether. Don't take my ether away. I don't know why he wants to. He obviously, I don't know whether he's vested a lot in it, or I don't know whether he's just like confirmationally biased with it or what. But what I do know is that if you're going to make the assertion that it proves something, I'm going to repeat what I said. You have to wiggle it, because if you didn't wiggle it, you didn't prove shit. So measuring something is not the same as wiggling it. And whatever we measured in that the Saganac experiment, yeah, you're getting a wave, you're getting like an interference pattern. But that's the measurement. That's what you're observing. That is your dependent variable. And the thing that we did manipulate, the presumed cause, definitely was not the ether. So if you're going to claim that it was the it did prove the ether, sadly not. You've got to manipulate that ether, because if you didn't wiggle it, then you haven't proved shit. So you can get all pissed off and butter if you want, Bob. You can slice people's head off. And you can manipulate people if you want to. But I'm going to remind people of that phrase that he said right at the very beginning, because I find it pertinent. Remain free from groupthink. I admit that I'm not intelligent enough to understand everything. I don't profess to. I'm not a physicist. I've not studied physics. But what I have studied is evidence. And when someone tells me this proves that the murder weapon was definitely a knife, and it turns out that it wasn't a knife at all, it was just a shard of metal, I can work out weak evidence from strong evidence, because that's what I was trained in. Does it prove the point that's being made? And the Saganac experiment, as cited by Bob, does not prove the point that Bob claims it proves. It was not proving the ether. If it was proving anything, I would assert that it appears to prove, perhaps maybe, that light travels at a finite speed in the medium that experiment took place in. Because one did seem to get there quicker, the other one seemed to get there a little bit slower. I might be wrong, but it definitely didn't prove the ether. So let's just remember that phrase that he gave, remain free from groupthink, after slicing Nathan's head off in the FE Core chat, because whatever reason, and we can all imagine what that reason was, but he's the one that's claiming remain free from groupthink. Well, I'm not intelligent enough to work it out on my own, Bob. I need that groupthink, because I need the context. I need the background. I need the conflicting opposing evidence that seems to make sense at the time without knowing that opposing evidence. But when you get told about it, oh shit, yeah, you realize that you've got something wrong. So let's not remain free from groupthink. Let's unite and put our brains together, because we can't work this shit out on our own. Yeah, it's all right pushing that you shouldn't be free, you shouldn't be indoctrinated by groupthink, but I wouldn't want to do this on my own. So if you're going to push the division card, I'm going to say that that's a dividing rule tactic. Maybe not, but let's not be afraid of a little bit of unity. It's not a dirty word, despite people pushing it around as though it is. Unity, cohesion, and even like the ability to disagree is not a dirty word. So why is it the case that people have to fall out with people over the shit like this? It's stupid. I'm going to say that it's purely egotistical. It's got nothing to do with the point in hand. And it's just, it is pride and ego, selfishness. So I'm done.
Well, the damnedest part of it all is the entire thing is moot anyway. Why? Well, there is no Coriolis effect with the Earth, right?
Yeah.
It's all, everything's, this is all moot. It's ridiculous.
Agreed. Oh, I do want to say one last thing. Bob criticized Nathan for picking the word ball busters. Let me just tell everybody what my suggestion was. My suggestion was, what was it now? Globe busters. It was Flobe flusters was my suggestion, because anything that we do is always called like Flobe instead of Globe, because it's us. And then flusters, panic, stretch, manic, threat. You know what I mean? Flobe flusters. I thought ball busters was very neutral, very kind, very like non-poking the bear. I know you took it that way, but I'd have gone with Flobe flusters, to be honest, Bob.
Any more?
I just got one more quick point that I wanted to clear up. The Sunday slot, there seemed to have been a problem about Can you hear me?
Yeah, sorry, go on.
There seems to be a problem with the Sunday spot. Now, what I don't understand is why would Bob get upset about somebody coming in and filling flat earth material in a place where there's nothing going on? You know, it's not one of those things like a player retires his jersey, and just because somebody is not occupying a certain spot, well, all of a sudden we have to reserve this slot of time in memoriam for another show until it comes back. So that was my take on that. I don't understand it. I want to get as much flat earth content as I can. And if a space opens up, I am surely happy to see anybody step in with some flat earth material and fill it, because it's not like we have it all. I mean, mainstream owns everything. They own 99% of all content. All we have is a little bit. So if the door opens up for flat earth content, somebody from flat earth, please step in and fill it. Thank you.
Nathan, you're not going to get away with rounding out. You need to conclude.
Oh, absolutely. I'm going to put my two penny worth in. I just want you guys to go first. So I'll do a few shout outs to the super chatters first. So I will preface this by saying I am very, very grateful to all of you who support the show, especially by smashing the super chat. It's a bit more fun than, you know, various other means that you can support the show, and I realize that YouTube get a cut of it. However, it's part of the engagement of the show. I like super chats. But there we go. I'm just going to shout out the people who super chatted in this show. So Eagle Plane and Anchor, thank you very much. Colin Turner, really appreciate your support. Mind of God, thank you very much for hitting the super chat. There's a couple that are doubled. I won't shout you out twice. Rob Wiggles, thank you very much indeed. Synth Hacker Bear, thank you very much for hitting the super chat. Earth is Seriously Flat, again, thank you very much indeed for hitting the super chat. So I think, and again, for hitting the super chat, Earth is Seriously Flat. So that's all the super chatters out of the way. Thank you very much for supporting the channel. So in conclusion, from my perspective, I only want to reiterate the main point which I made from the start, which is to say that we as a collective, everybody, has been duped into accepting a model, a reification of this heliocentric world we're told we live on. And the way they've done it is by telling you that they've got something empirical. And the way they do that is by using the terminology of an empirical method, the scientific method, and attributing it to things that have just been declared. And this exact methodology of making a declaration of science when there is none is what Bob has fallen victim to. Now, I don't want to penalise Bob for this. I just want him to understand and accept it so that moving forward, he can no longer apply scientific terminology that he has been in the past to observations, technology, whatever it is that he's doing. So if I'm going to check Ranty and Anthony and the Globers on the panel, and there's somebody in our midst that ends up putting themselves onto national television or worldwide television, I don't know how far Netflix expands, and what your misunderstanding has led an audience to believe is that one of our own flat earthers has proven that the earth spins with science. That's the bit I take issue with. If you're going to claim science, and it doesn't matter which side of the fence you sit, flat earth or globe earth, or any earth for that matter, if you claim you've got scientific proof of something, then I'm going to be the first to ask, what adherence to the scientific method does this proof have? And just simply ask the questions, you know, what's the observed phenomena, like John's asked when he's got dissected up what Bob has declared. So if it's not me, hopefully moving forward, other people will see exactly the same thing and hear those words, those now magic words of science, and ask themselves, is this really science? Is this actually the empirical method that proves the scientific prediction, otherwise known as a hypothesis, or not? And if it's not, it's just a declaration by a bloody wizard to sell tires. You'll think, maybe this isn't proof just because the person on the screen says so, using scientific vernacular. Just question it, like I've done with Bob. And if the reaction is to chastise you and cast you out into the wilderness, then you need to concern yourself even more and perhaps ask the question more often. Does this actually have any scientific validity? It's claimed to be an experiment. Do you have scientific proof of the ether? You've said it's been proven. And what method has been used? Well, it's been declared scientifically. Well, how do you test claims of that nature? Simple. You see if they're scientific. Have they adhered to the scientific method or not? And if they haven't, why haven't they? Moreover, why has it been asserted that they have? That's the trap that I don't want us to fall into. It's the trap that's got us on a spinning ball based on people looking at lights in the sky and then telling you what's what. Well, I'm sick of that. And personally, at this stage, I said it on the debate today, I've had enough of it. You know, the people who want a new priest become dangerous to the people who want truth. They want somebody else to observe and declare and be quite bold and forthright about it and unchallengeable. Well, isn't that the same as the priesthood we have now? Personally, I'm trying to get away from that priesthood. And I'm hoping that people, good people like Bob, also want to detach themselves from the old rhetoric, the old ways. And the arguments that are used day in day out in the debate when people say, this is science, is to rip it to pieces based on its lack of scientific validity. We'd be hypocrites if we didn't do this ourselves and just cherry-pick the bits of science with the observe and declare that we liked for our rhetoric. That's terrible. That's not going to progress truth. That's going to progress rhetoric and basically a new priesthood. And I don't want that. If somebody else wants it and they want part of it, then they're dangerous to me. So keep the hell away. Anyway, that's as much as I'm going to say on it. Is there any last notes that people want to put in before I round out?
No, very well said. Thanks.
Yeah, Sagnac experiment didn't prove either. Sorry.
Pretty much cleared it up.
Cool.
I agree. Yeah.
Well, with that, I'll say a massive, huge, enormous thank you to Betty von Valsen, John, otherwise known as Quantum Eraser, Anthony, otherwise known as Sleeping Warrior, Slick James Johnson, and of course, a massive, huge, enormous thank you to all of you in the live audience for tuning in, sharing, smashing the super chat and all that good stuff. Another big, massive shout out to Earth is Seriously Flat for hitting the super chat during the outro. Really, really appreciate your support. If you need something to do after this live stream has ended, then go to nathanoakley.com and check out the Flat Earth Debate Forum to keep up to date with the community debate. I've been Nathan Oakley, and I'll see you all in the next Ballbusters.